Listening Library presents I Crawl Through It. Written and read for you by A.S. King.
For Andrea Spooner. What is a weed? A plant whose virtues have yet to be discovered. Ralph Waldo Emerson. Prologue. The place where we explain the helicopter and how not to eat the green sauce at Las Hermanas, and we don't mention anything about love. Gustav is building a helicopter. Nobody knows because Gustav has been building it in small sections. He understands things like the physics of flight. He understands vectors. I could never understand a science that doesn't relate to humans or biology, but Gustav tells me his helicopter will be better than a stupid human. He says, "Can you fly?" Gustav believes his helicopter is invisible, and because he believes it, it is so. There are two seats in Gustav's invisible helicopter so he can take a passenger. There is space behind the seats so he can take a backpack, snacks, a camera, a helicopter map, maybe a parachute, maybe no parachute. It probably depends on his destination. "This isn't some dumb mini helicopter kit," he said when he explained it at first. "It cost me 50 grand. "Where'd you get that kind of money?" I asked. "None of your business," he said. Gustav is building a red helicopter. It's not invisible. If I want, I can see it on Tuesdays. Other people can see it on other days, but I can only see it on Tuesdays, which is when the number 10 combo is the dinner special at Las Hermanas, my favorite. Dos enchiladas. Always get the red sauce. The green will burn your eyes out. Gustav lives 3 blocks from Las Hermanas, so I stop by and see the helicopter on my way home. He is making good progress. Mama says Gustav is mad crazy. I think he's a genius. I think Mama is jealous. I think she would build a helicopter and take off as soon as she could, if she could, but she can't, so she doesn't, and she says lies about Gustav like, "That boy isn't right in the head, or he's going to end up in the Looney Tunes if he's not careful." Stanzi has a family history. Mama and Pop went on a trip this week. Usually they save the trips for weekends or summer vacation with me, but they said they wanted to go alone and asked if I could heat up my own TV dinners and stay safe overnight by myself. I'm a senior in high school, raised by them. I heat up my own TV dinners and stay safe overnight every day by myself. I didn't say it that way to them, though. I just said yes. So on Tuesday morning, they set their GPS for Newtown, Connecticut. That's where the 2012 Sandy Hook massacre was. I bet you could scan Mama's camera and I bet you'd find pictures of all the landmarks that were on TV. The firehouse, the neighbor's house, the school's parking lot. I bet you'd find 100 damp, balled-up tissues on the floor of Pop's Buick, too. It's like they're mourning the loss of me, and I'm still alive. It's like they're mourning the loss of something bigger than all of us, and they take me with them to show me the whole. I've already been to Columbine, Virginia Tech, the site of that Amish school, and Red Lake, Minnesota. We even flew to Dunblane, Scotland when I was 10. I own the most morbid snow globe collection in the world. For what it's worth, I can't lay one more cheap bouquet of flowers by a memorial. I can't light one more candle. I can't count out 20 fluffy teddy bears that will only wilt under the Connecticut winter snows. For what it's worth, I sobbed for 3 days after that guy shut up those kids in Newtown. I stopped using tissues because my nose got so raw. I didn't shower. I didn't talk. I didn't breathe hardly. Call me emotional or a drama queen, and I don't care. I'll tell you again, I fucking sobbed. Then I dissected a frog. It didn't make me feel any better, but it made me stop crying. Stanzi. Thursday. Another frog dissection. 1. Place frog in tray, ventral side up. 2. With forceps, lift the skin of the lower abdomen, cut with scissors. 3. Slide scissors into the opening and cut to below the lower jaw. 4. Cut the sides, just posterior to the forelimbs and anterior to the hind limbs. This is my 7th frog dissection this year. Mr. Bayer lets me help with the freshmen if they're dissecting. I am the best frog surgeon he knows. That's our joke. I bet he'd make me a name tag that says best frog surgeon if he could, but he's not very artistic. I'm his assistant, and I help hand out the forceps and scalpels while the students get into their lab coats and put on their goggles. I can't actually hand out the frogs, though, because I'm always surprised by how dead they are. Lifeless, gray-green, bred so we could cut them open and find their livers and draw them for points in a notebook. Mr. Bio told me in 9th grade, "You're going to make an excellent doctor one day." "That's the plan," I said. "It's a good plan." "I want to help people," I said. "Good. I know I can't help everybody, but even if I can help just one person, you know?" "Yep," he said. "I'm thinking about going into the army," I said. Mr. Bio made a horrible face. "Why?" "Did you ever watch MASH?" I answered. MASH is a late 20th century TV show about a mobile army surgical hospital unit during the Korean War. It reruns on cable a lot. The main character is Benjamin Franklin Hawkeye Pierce. He's a surgeon from Maine. "Of course," Mr. Bio said. "I grew up with MASH." "That's why," I said. I didn't tell him Hawkeye Pierce is my mother. No one would understand that. Hawkeye Pierce was a man, a fictional man. Most people would think he couldn't be anyone's mother. Except he's mine. He puts me to bed every night. He makes my dinner. He teaches me about the world, and he's always honest. Mr. Bio put his hand on my shoulder and said, "You should stay away from that recruiter." "It wasn't the recruiter," I said. "Well," he said, "there are better ways to pay off med school loans. We'll talk about it once you get closer to graduating." We did talk about it. I am now 60 days from graduating. Mama and Pop don't think going into medicine will be good for me. They think I should be a forest ranger. I have no idea why, especially on days like today when my scalpel knows just where to go. Especially on days like today when I don't even have to refer to the drawing to locate the heart, the stomach, the liver, the urinary bladder. Mama tells me that being a forest ranger will be quiet, that I will be safe. She says, "Trees help us breathe, you know." This morning, the school administration got a letter. The letter claimed to be from a student who was going to blow us all up before testing week. Nobody is supposed to know this, but I know. You want to know how I know, but I can't tell you that yet. The point is, somebody sent a letter and nobody knows who it was. But I might. He or she could be here with us today, scalpel in hand, and from here behind your plastic goggles, you'd never know he or she could write that and send it. He or she is not what you think. I don't think they ever are. Stanzi. Thursday. Formaldehyde. My frog is a contradiction, splayed out like a victim of violent crime, left for dead, one of many. The frog also looks peaceful. If a frog can look proud, then mine looks proud. If a frog can look the opposite of proud, then mine looks like that too. I'm like this, cut in two, divided. And so is the kid who sent that letter to the administration. Proud and humiliated at the same time, splayed and standing at attention, dead and utterly alive, split right down the middle, neck to groin. One freshman kid passed out so far. He joined the two conscientious objectors in the adjacent lab with the door closed so the smell of formaldehyde won't make them puke. I like the smell of formaldehyde. It preserves things. What's not to like about something that preserves things? Stanzi. Thursday. Tetra-Gam-Ee-Tic, Ky-Meer-A. Do you know what a Tetra-Gam-Ee-Tic chimera is? We learned about it during a genetics discussion last fall. It's some crazy thing that happens to you between when you're conceived as cells and when you're a zygote, somewhere between sperm meets egg and embryo, somewhere between the one-night stand and the trip to the drugstore for the test kit. Somewhere in there you used to be fraternal twins, and you blended, two into one. It is not murder or homicide, even though they were two and now there is one.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.